Hello, you malty mandalions.
Yeah.
Ralphie here. Welcome to Whisky Review 402. And that malt mention was provided by Thalhild. Thank you, Thalhild. Single malt time, malt mates. Oh, yes, I know how you tend to enjoy the single malt reviews the most. I review other spirits. I do. Occasionally, I might review some wines. I've got plans for that. But it really boils down to Scotch single malt whiskies. That's what you really come to Ralphie.com to learn about. But as they say, never limit your options, because quality can be found in the most unexpected of places. And to a certain extent, Scotch whisky is so internationally fashionable at the moment that many reasonably experienced malt hands are now saying to themselves, and it includes you probably, seeing as you've come to YouTube to watch this vlog, to educate yourself and a little bit of entertainment too. Anyway, I digress. Let's focus here. You'll notice that, such is the increasing demand, that you're having to diversify your field of examination when it comes to picking another bottle of whisky. Now, that is not necessarily a bad thing, because it's true, some single malt whiskies actually taste better generally than others from other distilleries. It just happens to be a fact. But when you have a single malt that's got so much demand for it, the producers inevitably, in trying to keep up, will, out of necessity, commercial expediency, and they can't really be blamed for it, although they could try harder to prevent it, quality drops a little bit. And particularly if you have been loyal to a certain brand, even though you can't put your finger on it, you will start to notice differences as suppliers try to provide greater volumes in order to keep up with greater demand. Now, at this point, you start to explore some of the other options, because quality can be found all over the place. There are certain distilleries that are kind of off the radar. They're not considered great quality distilleries, like Othrusk, Altmore, Tiananich, but they produce some great bottlings, because it's all about the cask. Good quality spirit in a good cask equals good results. And there's other things to watch out for. In younger whiskies, perhaps the non-age stated whiskies, it is not necessarily the case, although it can be, don't get me wrong, not necessarily the case that you're getting an inferior whisky simply because it's younger. And I'm going to present to you this Benromach Origins as a perfect example of a young, good quality whisky. And I'm going to tell you why. There's the bottle. Benromach is a little Scottish-owned distillery right in the Moray, Moray Firth, yep, got that one right, just up in the north of Scotland, east of Inverness, there you go, and small distillery, hands-on, dunnage warehouses, doing things the traditional way, and it shows. There are many Benromachs well worth the effort, and I do recommend them, and here's a very good example of that. It's called Origins. It's a non-age stated single malt. But when you look at it, you tend to think, well, you know, what's so special about this? It's not really kind of saying too much. However, the golden clue is in the back of the label. And if you get your reading glasses out, or you've got particularly good eyesight, or a steampunk magnifying glass, you will notice that it says Benromach Origins is a series of special bottlings crafted to highlight how subtle changes to the art of whisky making can help shape the character of the final malt. This third batch release, so it's the third batch release, and it's been bottled at 50% volume, by the way, so it's a virtual cask strength whisky, has been created using the finest optic barley. Now, there we have it. What you have here is a version of Benromach, which is relatively young, but the emphasis, the feature here, is not the years of maturation, but the quality of a particular variety of barley that's been used, the optic variety. Now, the probably one of the most famous variety of barleys in history, in recent history, has been Golden Promise, which up until recently was used at Glengoyne Distillery. But what happens is that over time, strains of barley are engineered and hybridized to increase productivity, to increase yield, to increase suitability for particular purposes. You know, these things do happen, but you don't really notice so much about them in whisky marketing. But what Benromach, in a most understated way, because it's all in small writing, are basically saying is here's a kind of limited edition, small batch, cask strength whisky, where it's all about the variety of barley that's been used. Just going to put this away now. The steampunk magnifying glass has served its purpose. Now I can lift up the glass. A gentle roll. Immediately, you notice a particular richness on the nose. You'd expect that. It's at 50% volume alcohol. But what I'm noticing as well, two things I'm noticing. One, it's been a particularly well-made, clean spirit for a relatively young age, very cleanly, professionally made. And secondly, I'm noticing that for a young spirit, there's a tremendous amount of natural, subtle complexity coming through from the spirit itself, not so much the cask. The cask is playing a minor role here. It's all about the spirit. And the spirit is, I mentioned, rich, but there's a lot of complexity going on in there. Now, before I taste it, bear in mind it's 50% volume. I'm going to do something that I wouldn't normally do. At 50%, I'd usually add a few teaspoonfuls of water. But in this case, because it's a young, relatively young spirit, I'm adding very little. So in fact, I'm going to be nosing and tasting an alcoholically high-strength whisky. And the reason for that is because I want to get the full effect of the spirit itself, rather than the maturation of spirit and cask. Nose. Rich, complex cereal. Honey. Green notes. Peas, garden peas. Mild, spicy sap. Greengage. Unripe pears. Guava. Mild mint, cookie dough, creamy, complex, sweet and sour, slightly bitter, slightly acidic, grain. Taste. Spirity, but very clean. Creamy spirit, not harsh. May bear in mind that I have added so little water to this that it's virtually at 48% alcohol, round about there. And yet I'm not getting the burn of alcohol. I'm not going, oh, too much alcohol, more spoonfuls of water. It just isn't that kind of whiskey. It's in fact creamy, honeyed, grain-rich, cereal-intense, soft, mild wood, very restrained oak influence, very restrained indeed. Some sawdust, mild mint, more complex mint, spearmint, apple mint, pineapple mint, developing a rich, bitter and sour grain. So for such a young spirit, you're getting a kind of development in the glass, which it takes a bit of getting used to if you're not knowing what to expect. You're getting the behaviour of a more matured whiskey, but it's happening in a younger whiskey because of the quality of the make of spirit. With water, little drop of water, you get that still a condensed, sweet and sour, cereal rich, syrupy, dried syrup malt with hay, dry honey, savoury vanilla, some hint of bitter lemon, and the finish, sour grain, vanilla, wood spice, and a hint of sap. It's proves the rule, actually, that when you try to apply rules to whiskey and any quality spirit, the whiskey will soon break the rules for you. The idea that in a strong, alcoholically strong spirit, you need to add a lot of water, it just doesn't apply here at all. In fact, to add too much water, it literally drowns it. There is such an intense delicacy going on here. Even over time, you know, even now I can taste, I smell a butteriness coming through in the grain. The actual richness of the grain is an experience, the malted barley, it really is quite an experience. This is the third edition. I don't know how many more they're doing, but as a single malt whiskey, it's absolutely fascinating and really good stuff. So much so that we're going to give this an 89 out of 100, and that's a malt mention. Malt. No, it's not a malt mention, what am I saying? It's a malt mark. It's different. So there you go. Any further little details that I'd like to add to this? Yeah, of course there are. Rather complex cereal malt, which is due to the production and ingredient quality rather than years of maturation. I'd put this around about 7 years old. Not that old. And I do, just to emphasise, with these styles of whiskey and you could basically, you're just adding a drop of water, you can get away without adding any water at all, but it's easy to add too much to drown the experience or compromise the flavour significantly. So general rule is, when you're adding water to whiskey, add a drop, add a little drop more, because you can always add a bit more if you need it. But once you've added too much, it's very hard to really recover the experience you're looking for. You really have to finish the glass and pour another one. You can't just add whiskey to kind of reconcentrate the alcoholic degree. It just doesn't work. And I've noticed that it develops after about 15 minutes in the glass for a young single malt. It develops in the most unusual way. The cereal sort of settles down and you get almost a sort of slightly toasted note. So in fact, you're having a kind of development window that you would normally associate with older matured whiskies that have more cask involvement. But such is the richness, the condensed nature of the grain, that you're getting an older effect from a younger bottling. And this very elegantly and very articulately proves that younger single malts are not necessarily less good. Don't get me wrong. There are malts which are being bottled younger simply because suppliers want to meet demand and get money into the business quicker. And that's not really the right thing to do in the long term, because there comes a point where it compromises the reputation of a distillery. And to lose an age statement altogether from bottlings, in my opinion, is risky and potentially a mistake. But that's another subject for another day. Anything more I'd like to add? Well, not really. All I would say is that Benromach is a very interesting distillery to watch, because the owners, Gordon MacPhail, do an awful lot and have done an awful lot over the years of experimentation with wood conditioning, styles of oak, types of cask and all the rest of it. And in a sense, they've been doing this as a company before most other distilleries. So they have the advantage of experience. And I think what you'll find over time with Benromach single malt is the calibre of casks being used and the care in the preparation of the casks is really quite high, and it's a bit of a standout. And particularly over time, older bottlings of Benromach will be particularly good quality indeed. Certainly the young versions are pretty decent. But this, well, I just had my radar going and the signal popped up. So I bought this bottle, and I tell you what, I'm glad I did. So thanks for watching. I appreciate your company as always, because I know you're interested in whisky, as I am. Sharing the journey, malt mates, that's what we're doing. Join me again shortly for Whisky Review 403. We'll be reviewing another single malt, beginning with the letter S. From Speyside. That narrows it down a bit, but no spoilers. See you soon.